Hi, I'm Fred McNeil, and thank you for watching QACTV7. You're watching Conversations with Fred. Each week, we have different people come in from the community, men and women, talking about interesting things going on, programs they need to know about, and we want you to know the people who are trying to make this a better community. Today is Education Day. We've had the Teacher of the Year, and we're delighted. I want you to look at the name, write it down, and I'll give you the phone number later if you want to call, all right? Dr. Patricia Saelens, all right? Our new superintendent. Congratulations, Dr. Saelens, for getting the job. That's exciting. Okay?
Thank you. It's very exciting.
Okay. How about we start out? Let the public know who you are, where you're from, where you went to school. How about we start there, if it's all right.
Absolutely. Well, I'm a shore girl. I've been here my whole life.
Okay.
Grew up in the Easton area.
Okay.
Easton High School. Easton High School. Went to school at Salisbury, graduated as a teacher, and then moved on and got my master's through Salisbury.
All three of my kids went there, Doc.
It's a great place.
Yes,
And then they didn't at the time have a doctoral program, so I did take my doctoral studies through Wilmington University.
And for all the old teachers out there and all the people who went to Queen Anne's County High, Dr. Saelens knows Merv Daugherty, right?
Yeah.
Now the superintendent of Richmond. She knows, Merv, we love you, but the hand's on the wallet. Okay, all right. So you got your PhD from Wilmington.
Yes, my educational doctor from Wilmington. And so I have two children. Right. They're grown.
You got PhD candidates. Yeah. Tell us what we got here with the kids.
So Christiana's 25.
Mom, you get to brag. We'll forget the doctor thing for 30 seconds.
Okay, so Christiana's 25. She's married to Patrick. He's a lovely person, a wonderful person. And they've been married about a year.
Great.
She's in a PhD program in Mississippi.
University of Mississippi?
University of Mississippi.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Oxford, Miss. That's a beautiful place.
She's actually in Jackson at the Jackson Medical Center.
Okay, okay.
It's in microbiology and immunology, so I call her my science geek, I have to say.
I couldn't pass
really
college chemistry one. I couldn't, much less microbiology.
So she's finished all her comps and now just started a fellowship for her research. So she has about 2 years left. Thank you. And then Michael is awesome. He's 23. He's pursuing a degree in forensic accounting at Salisbury University.
Good.
And so he has about a year left.
Well, good for you. You've done some great parenting. Congratulations.
Thank you.
And you live here in Queen Anne's County.
I live here in Queen Anne's County.
Everyone's going to ask, does she live here in Queen Anne's County?
Yes, I live here in Queen Anne's County. I've moved here recently and I've already started to enjoy everything they have to offer here from restaurants.
You're going to be spoiled here. You're going to be spoiled.
Okay? Yes.
I mean, Queen Anne's County, like Talbot County and Denton, the Caroline County area, it's kind of unique and special. You've got, as you know, you've got Kent Island as one personality. Upper County another. We've got the rural and the suburban all mixed up, but it makes a wonderful combination.
Yes, absolutely.
Well, good. That's terrific. Now, how about career-wise?
Career-wise,
did you always want to teach and be an educational one?
Actually, I really started on the path of accounting.
Okay.
One of my brothers is an accountant. Not necessarily, and that's why I quickly realized that, hey, I think I have some other talents that I may have to go.
Okay.
So I started out in accounting and quickly knew that that probably wasn't the best for me. And so I moved it quickly into teaching after that and stuck with that, and it really was
a perfect
fit.
Did you teach on the shore?
So I did teach on the shore. Okay. My first year I taught in Talbot County, and then I moved to Dorchester County and was with them for 14 years.
And you survived my son-in-law, John Harper, who's now vice principal down there.
Okay,
John's a very talented young man.
He really is. So that was my first family, I call them. My first educational family, Dorchester County, under the direction of Dr. Spicer Bell, who was an amazing mentor. And then moved from there to Caroline County and spent the last 15 years of my career there. So they're my second educational family and delightful people to work with.
And now you're going to have your third and your best, all right? We're going to make it the best, okay?
Yes, and I'm very much looking forward to developing the relationships and creating a new family here in Queen Anne.
Okay, you sound like your career was me. Chemistry 101 decided I wasn't going to medical school.
Okay.
We worked that out. Well, all right. Did you enjoy the classroom?
I absolutely adored the classroom. I love getting into the classrooms. As a matter of fact, I was able to hit every school at least before the last day of school. So I was able to do a school visit.
Jeff used to this year
and got into some of the classrooms and saw some of the amazing things that our teachers here in Queen Anne's are doing. Jeff, so much fun.
Has Jeff given, Mr. Straight, your PR person, giving you the guided tour yet?
He hasn't given me the guided tour yet.
Look, we're going to let out a secret. He gives the best first day of school tour in the world. He'll take you, you hit all 14 schools in one day.
Right.
And it's an amazing experience. And
I'll tuck that back here.
Yeah, get Jeff, get him out of the office and get him to do
exactly.
it.
Exactly, exactly.
Now tell me, do you have a list of things you'd like to see done here in Queen Anne's County? Or
that there's so many amazing things already going on, so I really want to be able to capture what we're doing really, really well so we can make sure that we continue to do those things. So that's probably my first priority. Is to learn and listen. And then I would say that I noticed that there's an opportunity to do some strategic planning. So their strategic plan is up this year, and so it's like perfect opportunity to start pulling
in. Rewrite where you want to go.
Exactly. So pulling all your stakeholders and really look at, you know, where do we need to go? What are some areas doing needs assessment? What are some areas that we could grow in? And then take that information and really kind of run with it, creating some objectives.
And, that's your roadmap and, for the next 10 years and next
5
year
years,
or whatever.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, do like a 5-year, looking out 5 years, what does it look like? What do we want to be in 5 years? But there's so many really good things to build on already.
Okay.
So I think that'll be a pretty easy process.
Someone who I was teaching up the last March or the March before, you've got wonderful staff, administrators and teachers, your
Absolutely.
Teacher of the year, who Stephanie
just
McKenzie
yes.
just on, has more energy in her little finger in my whole body.
Yeah.
And all your teachers are like that. It's going to be really great.
Yes.
Now, what do you think about, I said this to Stephanie, I've said this to all my teacher friends. I went to school in the 50s and the 60s, taught from the 70s up to recently. I think more changes are about to happen in education and did happen in education because of the COVID virus.
Oh, absolutely.
I don't know. How in the world are you going to all of a sudden get 7,000 students this fall back in school? You had a wonderful summer program coming up.
Yes, We already started.
Yes, I have a grandson and he loves it.
Yes.
Kevin Kintop and that gang did a good job.
They did an amazing job.
How are you going to plan for kids who haven't been in school for 14 months?
Right.
Teachers who haven't had full classrooms before. What's the thinking? How's it going to go?
Yeah, so it's a heavy lift for this summer, to be honest with you, but I know that the supervisors have already started working on providing professional development opportunities and working with principals to ensure that the classrooms are ready to receive students. So those are some things that we're doing this summer, providing a lot of professional development for teachers and curriculum writing and all kinds of things that, that we typically do in the summertime, but it's just we're ramping things up, I guess, a little bit more. We have had several silver linings that have come out of COVID. And, one of those are our cleaning protocols, so we're going to continue with those.
Good.
And that'll be one thing that we're getting ready.
Right.
We're getting ready for, the fall is to make sure that we're prepared cleaning-wise to be able to continue those practices because they're good practices to have. I mean, we could, not just COVID, but look at the flu season we usually have, or those types of things to reduce
We might
that.
Have the next wave, the Delta wave of the COVID. We
right?
don't know
we
what's
don't know.
Coming down the pipe.
Exactly, but trying to prepare and plan for that is what we're going to be doing this summer. So hiring, making sure that we get
and teaching shortages, right?
Right,
I mean,
exactly.
People, just what I read in the paper. I don't know what's happening in Queen Anne's County. But you have systems who want to offer programs they can't get people to
right.
go into it.
Yeah, it's definitely staffing has been challenging even before COVID. That we just know that the teaching profession, there's so many other opportunities for our young men and women to go into. We didn't always have biomed and engineering I could sit here and
list
a
whole new world of jobs out there, right?
Exactly. Yeah. So, teaching has tended to fall a little bit, but on the shore as an ESMEC group, which is your Eastern Shore leaders, we've really worked hard with Salisbury University to recognize that we have a teacher shortage and to promote teaching. We all have academies, we do right here in Queen Anne's, we have a teacher right. academy program, so promoting it within the system, growing your own, as they say, so working hard on that as well.
All the teachers, they heard you were coming on. I have to let you know on a secret. Ask her about snow days.
Oh.
Well, my question is going to be, the virtual teaching you all did and did an excellent job with the last year, will that change the way we look at things like fog days and snow days? And what do you think?
Yeah, so we're hopeful, but of course that is finalized at the state level. Mm-hmm. We are getting a new state superintendent. He starts on July 1.
Okay.
And so that's going to be one of the first things on our list.
The big state of Texas, I believe,
yeah.
Isn't it?
Yes. Okay. So that'll be one of the first things that are on our agenda to say, hey, you know, what are some direction that we have with this? What are, you know, what guidelines or leeways do we have with doing that? Ideally, that would be great. But we do have to also remember we do have a population of our students and our staff who aren't fully connected, meaning, you know, with internet-wise.
Up north, whether we like it or not, it's in
trouble. So until we kind of get that remedied, it's not a sure for everyone.
Okay.
But looking at those asynchronous Wednesdays where you have opportunity over a period of days to get an assignment due, you know, that might be something we could do. So I don't have a final answer right now, but we certainly have it
it's
on.
It's going to change things, isn't
it? Right. It's certainly a talking point and certainly a good way to look at things.
I think it'd be a great time to be a superintendent, because I think you're the old turkeys like me, and we come to your, oh, by the way, please make sure you come to, Richard McNeil runs a wonderful retired teachers association. He's the president. Make sure you go there, and I'm sure
Absolutely.
You will. We all taught in a model that probably was developed in 1830, I hate to admit it. You, I think, and the staff are going to be dealing with a model that's going to, the rule's going to change.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, like I said, all the teachers saying, we've lost our snow day. Well, why not? If we can teach virtually,
right.
why not?
Yeah.
Fog days, maybe we don't, maybe we can, you know, the possibilities are just unlimited.
Yes,
right?
And absolutely.
I think and it's a great time to be in education,
yes.
which will be kind of fun.
You know, and I wanted to give a shout out. We are doing a ESMEC virtual program.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, in the past we've had many students, and I'll just use the example of our homeschooled students. The homeschool students are not enrolled in the public school
right,
itself.
Correct.
So they're not a part of Queen Anne's County public schools. But our ESMEC virtual program will allow them to be enrolled with Queen Anne's County public schools and still do their learning virtually. And so that's something that, you know, we have wanted to do for so many years. We're forced to do it during COVID, and now we can make that an option.
We can grow from it. Okay.
Right, exactly. So our students who are at the middle school level and high school level will have that option. And hopefully, eventually, we'll be able to do it in elementary. We're just not prepared to do that this school year. Hopefully, maybe the following
year.
You know,
exactly,
to grow it out. But it's a really exciting opportunity that we've partnered together, all 9 Eastern Shore superintendents.
Oh,
and so we're excited about that. So if people want more information, then you should call in to, you know, support services, student services.
Now, I'll pat you on the back to start out with the event you had, I believe, at Centerville Elementary School the other day. I think you had administrators of the second floor people in the Board of Ed. They loved, I mean, the feedback I got.
Yes.
Look, you get an A+. Board of Ed members double our salary already. The administrators from the Board of Ed. So I think what this county, and again, I'm an outsider, I know nothing. The idea of having somebody with enthusiasm, somebody who realizes maybe there has to be some changes in education, and apparently the pats on the back, so whatever you did the other day, tell the public what you did the other day.
I had 2 meetings, one on Monday, one on Tuesday, to meet with principals and meet with supervisors, just to kind of say, hey, you know, I'm not a person to have a meeting just to have a meeting.
Right.
However, I said, today we're going to have a meeting just to have a meeting, because we just need to all hang out with each other for a couple hours to just, you know, be able to ask questions and kind of get to know who I am and my style. And so it was probably our only meeting that we'll ever have.
You picked up a lot of points. I mean, it doesn't matter, but what I heard, I thought it was
good,
delightful.
Good.
Now, the other good news, I think, and I make sure I'm saying this correctly, the county commissioners, working with the Board of Ed and yourself, approved a new Board of Ed building. Is that correct?
Yes.
Can you talk about that?
I don't know that I have a whole, you know, I can go into great detail, only because I haven't sat with the commissioners, and I'd rather have an opportunity to sit with them. But yes, I believe that they have approved that they're in, you know, they've done a feasibility study of the current building to realize that might be too much of a project. And money-wise, to be able to, it'd be more efficient to build a new building.
Right.
So I think they've done that whole process prior to me coming in the door, and I think at this point they're in the planning stage. And
so
then,
that's certainly a possibility.
Certainly, yes.
I think it's going to be right here.
Exactly right.
I worked in that building for years. The cracks in the walls, you have a basement.
It's different. I haven't done the basement yet.
Don't go down.
I was warned, don't go in the basement.
Do me a favor. Don't go in the basement.
Yeah, I'm not going in the basement.
Get your husband to go down, or your son, or your daughter. Please don't go down.
Yeah.
You'll see, you won't go back upstairs.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, I think some things you're doing, I mean, just some feedback I'm getting, you moved your PR department, or you plan to move your PR department.
Yes.
It's more accessible on the first floor. You want to talk about that at all or not?
Well, they're just making some minor changes. I mean, the building is very challenging. Yeah. We just talked about that. It's a very challenging building. But yeah, just trying to reorganize just enough to be able, like you said, who do you want to see when you first come in the door?
Sure.
You know, and unfortunately, you know, a little bit of that design will have to go into the new building because
right.
it's not necessarily possible
sure.
with the building we're in. But, you know, people want to come in, they either go to HR or they want to talk to your communications person, right? Or they want transportation, to be honest with
right.
you. So the most of, so when you reorganize that building, when we look to the future of the new building, we want to make sure that it's reconfigured a little bit so that it's more accessible for the
and
public
you're going
and
in the classroom A. You're going on the second floor, is that true?
I am.
Well, good.
So, yeah.
It always blew my mind that you'd walk in the building and there was a superintendent's office, which you couldn't get in, they were too busy.
Yeah.
Put the PR people, like you said,
exactly.
HR and somebody.
Yeah.
Now, it sounds like are you kind of hands-on visiting schools?
Yes.
And what's your philosophy in terms of visiting schools and that type of stuff?
So, you know, I feel like not only just me, but the board member. So, of course, we sit on a board together. I'm actually a member of the board.
Right.
And so I think all of us need to be champions of our schools. And so we should be very visible in the schools. I encourage the board members to go out to different events and celebrate, you know, whenever we have an opportunity to celebrate. But over and above that, I just like to be in the schools. I do formal visits 3 times a year, and that doesn't include like your opening day and everything.
Right,
but to get in the classrooms, literally take tours, go into every classroom, and be able to sit down
good
with the kids.
Good for the students and the teachers to see the
for
so many systems, the superintendent is somebody who's out there as a name and use it, and it means nothing.
But we're smaller,
yes,
so we can do that.
We've only got four.
Yeah,
we talked off the air. You have to go in the famous Jeff Strait, 14 schools in one day.
I'm going to take that challenge.
It's a great, you start at 8 o'clock and the first school opens on Ken Island. You work your way up. You see all this. But the kids.
Yeah.
I know when I went with Dr. Sadusky or Dr. Williams and everyone who we went with, the kids would walk up because superintendent's kind of myth. What is a superintendent?
Right.
And some of the best jobs are when you just say, well, look, my job is to make sure your food's going well, the buses are going well, the instruction, the most important thing. How about instructional changes? Now, are you a big curriculum person?
I am a big curriculum person.
Oh, tell me, what changes are we going to see?
Definitely came through the curriculum side of the house, as we call it, the curriculum side of the house.
Okay.
So as of changes, I mean, right now, I don't want to change anything.
No,
I mean,
fine.
Queen Anne's County
is, test scores,
you know,
still good?
Yes.
Oh,
well,
okay.
It's interesting because we haven't had the opportunity to really, truly test our students
COVID.
You know, high-stake testing. Of course, we've been doing diagnostics, and we'll continue to do that because we, you know, we'll see that there's been some learning loss there. So we need to make sure that we do diagnostics to pinpoint individual needs of students. But so we haven't really officially had data since 2019 school year, but it's coming back. But Queen Anne's has always been very strong, especially on the shore.
We were typically
number one on the shore, but very competitive in every other aspect of it. So there's a lot going on that's right. And I always say that if it's not broken, then let's not try to fix that. But, you know, we will be doing a curriculum audit to see, is there some areas that we can grow in? And that'll come through the strategic plan process. Yeah.
If we'll have a little fun here. If you had a magic wand, okay, I'm giving you the powers to be, okay, wherever they come from, what would you like to, if I put you on a road, where would you like to be at the end of your first term 4 years from now? Are there some couple things, I mean, take a minute to think or two, I'm putting you on the spot. Are there some things you'd like to, I know when Bernie Sadusky was the superintendent, he wanted 2 high schools. We only had Queen Anne's High School. He said after this term, I want to have a new high school. I don't want the poor kids from Kent Island have to drive up here. Vocational or career education, that type of thing. We have the wing at this high school, Queen Anne's High School,
but
the Kent Island kids have to come up.
Mm-hmm.
So if you had this magic wand, Dick Smith and the Board of Ed, don't get mad at me, we're not working behind your back. But there's some things you like to say, hey, I'd like to wave the flag in favor of artificial turfs, more Latin in the school. Are there any items?
You know, I think equity for me is a big thing, and that
that
goes to what you were just saying, that at one school we have one thing and not at the other, and that some students, you know, so I think providing access, it's all about access, right? I mean, if we could eliminate, you know, everybody talks about the achievement gap. We need to eliminate the achievement gap, but it's really eliminating the opportunity gap. That's okay. What I think about it. So when we look at our very littles, that's that's me. I just call them the littles. So sure. I'm talking about our pre-K, KK, etc. And we look at their student readiness. So I think one big thing would be that that again we work with our community partners at that youngest
get
age level.
Get the younger ones more youngest, ready.
Yes, okay. Get them more ready. So, you know, ideally for me, I would love to see every single one of our pre-K students be able to go full day.
Oh, okay. I mean, make it a full day program
that
countywide.
That would be amazing because then I know that they're going to be ready for kindergarten.
And
there's some monies there, but there's not space there. And that's one thing that we really have to look into. There are some monies. We would need additional monies. But the spacing, I mean, some of our schools we could do it, but you know, you're thinking of right now, if you have a pre-K class that comes in the morning and then a different pre-K class that comes in the afternoon, now obviously you have to have two classrooms because they have to go, right, you have to double your space. So that probably for me would be a huge goal because we know that students who are ready for kindergarten, you know, are much more successful.
Oh, sure.
Studies, in their entire
unlimited
career.
Unlimited amount of studies. You get a typewriter right now.
Right. So imagine you're eliminating interventions or, you know, all these other things that you're trying to do to fix the gap. You're eliminating that because you've now opened it up and you've removed the opportunity gap. Everybody has the same opportunity.
Okay.
And so that for me would be a big thing.
That'd
and I think that all lends itself to equity. As I said, equity to me is really opportunity, making sure that everyone has an equal opportunity for whatever they need, whatever, you know, direction they need to go into. So that would be a big one for me.
Okay. Probably. We're seeing, another question, we're seeing in the northern end of the county more so a wonderful influx, in my opinion, of a Hispanic population. Mm-hmm. All of a sudden we have a language issue, right? How do we prepare for that as a system? I mean, I think I'm putting you on the spot a little bit, but all of a sudden, this has been a certain type of community for so many years. Now we're looking at it and we're seeing, you know, Sudlersville, middle school, elementary school, they're getting a different population.
Absolutely.
It's not going to shrink.
No.
In my opinion. I mean, I'm right.
No.
How do we prepare for that?
So, good question. You know, I think we have to look at it a couple different ways as it relates to when we get the students. Mm-hmm. So when those students are from our area and born here in our area and we get them as littles, we don't have any problem because we are able
to immerse them right in the program.
Exactly. Right, and we can give them all, and talking about that, especially with that full day pre-K, you know, and giving them that extra time there. I mean, we've noticed that
socialization skills,
it's all about acquisition of language. Right. So when we can get them at that very young age, we can not have a problem. Now, the challenge is when those students come in at either upper middle school or at the high school level, that's much more challenging.
Sure.
And I think as a state we are, and probably as a nation, we're having a more difficult time with that because they come with almost zero language acquisition, but then they have the same expectations as any other graduate, you know, which is not a bad thing. We want kids to all have high expectations. But at some point, are we putting them at a disadvantage that they never can reach that diploma and we're frustrating them or whatnot? You know, so we need to really work on it as a state of what can we give our students who are coming to us with zero language at the high school level? What can we provide for them to get them to a point where they can acquire the skills necessary to be functioning in society? And not necessarily taking chemistry 101 physics and things like that.
Let's get the English skills, let's get the socialization skills,
et cetera. Exactly.
How about something that's always been on the back burner of Queen Anne's County? I don't even know what they call it. Votech Center, a career center, we kind of touched on it. Do you see, looking at the crystal ball, is that an issue in the future that we have a Votech Center? One time we had the land, I know when I was on the Board of Ed, we had the land and a lot of interest, and the state approved it to build a new building in Graysonville. That way the kids didn't have to go up and down the highway and that type of thing.
Right.
I mean, is that being thought about, or are we past that?
I haven't talked about that yet. I really haven't had a chance to get into that yet, but I will tell you the importance of
CT. Next time I have you in the show, you got to be an expert in everything.
Okay. I will tell you, though, that the CTE program is extremely important and that, you know, evaluating those programs and making sure that we are providing the programs necessary of what students really want to do, that's really important.
Yeah.
or the things that they need to be doing in order to, you know, come out of those programs and be successful right here in our own community. So we'll continue to look at that. You know, facility-wise, I don't know.
No,
I can't predict that right now. But
you just lost your transportation director.
Yeah.
You're losing. No, and the boomers like myself.
Yes.
It's time you need the next generation to come along. So you get to mold maybe your own staff a little bit, that type of thing. And like I said, you put Jeff Strait in the first floor. We can all watch him. You're in good shape. Okay.
Exactly.
Now I have to have a fun question. Who are you going to cheer for in football games? North Carolina, Talbot County? How are you going to do that?
I don't know.
Doctor, I would suggest you don't go to those events. Go to the cross-country meets. They're my type of thing.
Exactly. Yeah.
And you have a daughter. Let's talk about this coming. Is this the daughter coming back from Mississippi? Who's coming?
She just came home last night.
And she's here till Monday.
Till Monday,
so we're going to stop here in a second. Yeah. So you need to spend time with her.
Are
you going anywhere or are you just staying at home?
No, we're just hanging out. We're actually just having the whole family over.
Oh,
and it'll be the first time. So everybody's
going to
be there, but like four, and that's almost 30 of us. So
it's going to be a great
big family.
Okay.
So it's going to be a good time.
So your superintendent of schools, you're going to have to organize a family get-together.
Yes,
you got to
yes.
take the next week off. Right?
I know.
Okay,
all
right. All right. Make sure you know, and I'm going to do this on the air. If any time you or Jeff knows, my program is open to education whenever.
Absolutely.
I hope we get you right before school. You
get
to ride in the Queen Anne's County Fair this year. How's your Queen of
King's
Way?
I'm going to try. I have to practice a little bit.
Have you ever been to the Queen Anne's County Fair?
I have not.
Let me tell you what. I really mean this. I've been going for 40-some years. It's a delight. Two things will happen, right? You have, for years, the Board of Ed has had a table there.
Mm-hmm.
And if you just stand there after the parade, I mean it, 100 people, if not 1,000 people, will not only shake your hand and welcome you, but
awesome.
Is my little Johnny, and, you know, that type of, you're going to get those questions
as
you know. But it's a great way. Jeff is, the PR department's there the whole time, and you'll just be there a night or two. But it's a great way to meet the community. You're going to love the fair. They do a wonderful job.
Awesome.
And as an Eastern Shoreman, you know, it's a traditional Eastern Shore, nice and quiet, nice and calm. Go Wednesday night for the chicken. All right, that's
okay.
My hot tip, okay?
All right.
All right, we're sorry. But please, and again, I want to say it again, congratulations
Thank
on getting
you.
The job. Best
Thank
of
you.
Luck.
Thank you. Use
our TV station whenever you like. We'll help education any way we can.
I will.
Okay?
Absolutely. Looking forward
All
to
right.
many opportunities.
Now we have 2 minutes left. The toughest questions of the day. Ready?
Okay,
put on your thinking cap.
All right.
I do this with all the guests. It's
okay.
fine. Favorite ice cream?
Oh, my gosh. Just vanilla, probably.
Vanilla is nothing wrong. A little chocolate. Okay.
Yes.
Favorite actor? Male, female? Take your time.
Oh, my goodness.
Whatever pops
I'm
out.
I'm not a big, like,
movie. Then you can say
and,
I'm not a movie person.
Yeah, I'm just not a big TV person.
Oh, tell me favorite TV program.
A TV program, I don't know, probably 60 Minutes, to be
honest.
Oh,
nothing wrong with that. If you're going to be a superintendent of schools, you certainly need to know that. All right. How about favorite, I probably already know the answer, favorite place you've traveled to?
Favorite place I've traveled, probably to St. John.
St. John Islands? Or,
yes.
Oh, wow.
Virgin
okay.
Islands.
Just like the whole island, Caribbean type setting?
Yes, yes.
Oh, okay.
Beach
Very
person,
good.
Yes.
If you could sit down with anybody, male, female, but just one, have dinner with, you can have your family if you want, okay?
Okay.
Who would it be out of history? That can be
out
anyone
history.
You want.
Oh, my gosh. Probably... Einstein.
Oh, there's nothing wrong with that. I know your
just
daughter.
Just because he's so smart and you're just like, you know,
okay,
I don't know.
Your daughter would be the only one who could understand him, right? Because she's that smart. Okay. Well, look, our time's about up. Again, please come anytime you can and good luck, right?
You've got
to be great for the
Thank
community,
you.
All right?
Thank you so much.
My name's Fred McNeil. Thank you for watching this. My time's up. We're going to see you next time. Thank you.